Today we will start with a new lesson, Alchemy of Nature, written by Raksha Bharadia. Okay, so to begin with, what do we mean by alchemy? So alchemy is an ancient forerunner of chemistry about attempts to convert base metals into gold. Okay, so alchemy was a chemical which they were trying to use to convert metals into gold. Okay. But over here in this particular chapter where we are talking about nature, it refers to a mysterious magical process of transforming things. Okay, so how that is done, we will look at the chapter and then we will come back to this definition to understand it much better. Okay, so the chapter begins with a small poem written by William Blake: to see a world in a grain of sand and a heaven in a wild flower, hold infinity in the palm of your hand and eternity in an hour. So what does this particular poem mean? The poem means that you can see a world, you can get an idea or a concept from a grain of sand, and you can enjoy, you can see the beauty of heaven in a small wild flower that grows in gardens, and hold infinity in the palm of your hand. So infinity is an endless space, right? You can't really hold infinity, but what you can hold is your destiny. Your life is in your palm of your hand. That is your infinity, because that is what you're going to be experiencing throughout the life, and eternity in an hour. Now eternity is also an endless time, but just an hour in your life can make a difference to the world. That means you can, in an hour, you can do something which is so helpful for the world, which can be so great for other people as well as for yourself. Okay, so let's move on to the chapter. The chapter starts by saying that we instinctively turn to outdoor activities and nature as a way of relaxing and enhancing our well-being. So what do we mean by instinctively? Instinctively means naturally, without anybody forcing us to turn in a particular way, or without even us thinking that we want to turn that way, we move towards nature to experience it, and as a way of relaxing and enhancing our well-being. Enhancing means to improve, to enrich our well-being. What does nature do? Why? Because nature soothes. That means it comforts us and nurtures. Nurtures is, it takes care of us. It is similar to a mother who takes care of her child. That is what nature does. Nature takes care of us, and it also enhancing. It is very enhancing, right? It is enriching, and it also fulfills and motivates you. And the author is asking that, are you listening to that? Do you listen to the nature? And she's saying that when she does listen to the nature, it leaves her in complete awe. Complete awe means it leaves her in a surprise. Okay, so moving on, the author talks about a hibiscus plant that she has in her garden. Every fortnight, fortnight means every 15 days, a flower blooms on it, which is big, bright and tender. Big, bright and tender means soft, delicate. Okay. And throughout the day, that day when it blooms, it smiles and dances with the sun and the wind. But as the evening approaches, it starts wilting. Wilting means it starts drying and dropping. That murjhane lagte hai. And then in the next morning, it withers completely, and by evening it falls and becomes one with the earth again. Withers completely matlab it falls off, it dries off completely and falls to the ground by the night time. But what she is trying to say is that when it is in bloom, when it is only for one particular day, but even then it is in its full splendor. What do we mean by splendor? It is very bright and happy. Okay. Then moving on, she talks about her experience of going to a rocky beach and saw the spread of the majestic ocean. Majestic ocean means huge, big, ocean and the rocks alongside carved, sculpted and shaped by the water. So what they saw was that water is so gentle, it is so, you can't, water is not hard, it can't hit anybody, but and the rocks are so hard, but when the water flows over those rocks again and again every day for years and years, the rock gives in. That means the rock molds itself to the shape that the water is forcing the rock to take. Okay, so when we compare it to our lives, we compare it to our problems, we should think about it that they are so colossal. That means they are so huge. But if we make effort and if we are persistent like the ocean and we are facing our and forcing towards our problem, then we will easily be able to solve our problems and mold it in a way that we want. That means we can mold our life the way we want it to be. Similarly, she's talking about small bits of grass peeping through the small cracks in a concrete pavement. You must have noticed this in your buildings or somewhere like that, in the roads, on the roads. There are small grasses that come out of cracks, right? So, and you would think that how is it possible? So, that is exactly what the author is trying to tell us, that these, even if things may seem impossible, it is not really impossible. There is always an opening. What we have to do is just to find it. Okay. Then similarly, she's talking about a bare tree that she saw in the cold winter months. So generally during the winters, the trees fall, the leaves fall off the trees and the tree is completely bare. And you would think that its chapter was over. What do we mean by that? We mean to say that the tree is dead. Okay. But as months pass and spring comes in, the tree starts to bloom back and it gains its green majesty once again. And it is again full of leaves and flowers, birds and life. Okay. So what the author is trying to say that, what if we too had the conviction that however difficult things are right now, it will not remain so forever. That means if we stay firm and if we firmly believe that even though the times are difficult right now, it won't always be the same. So for example, we can take our particular example, the situations we are facing right now, the coronavirus situation. So even though these are difficult times, we know that eventually it will pass and we will all be able to go out and enjoy with our friends and family and the nature. Mostly we will be able to go out and enjoy the nature, right? So now the author is talking about an army of ants who was lugging a fly. That means they were pulling a fly which was 10 times their size. And she was thinking that how is it possible that they're able to do it on their frail feelers. Frail feelers means weak legs. Okay. And how are they able to carry it to quite a distance? And she noticed that it was because of their teamwork and perseverance. Perseverance means their efforts, their constant efforts to do that. So what how is she relating it to real life? She's saying that even if we were so consistent, organized and focused on our work, on our efforts towards something that we want to achieve, it would not be very difficult for us to achieve it. But one thing that we need is that we have to be consistent. Okay. Similarly, she is comparing that to a spider's web. Okay. Which when you look at it, you will see that it is very delicate, but it is also very strong. Then she's moving on and talking about a rainbow that colors the entire sky. What she's trying to say is that you can put color to your world. If a rainbow can color the entire sky, you can at least put colors in your life, right? Then moving on, she talks about oysters, how oysters take a grain of sand and they turn them into pearl, right? So you can put in efforts and you can turn out to be a pearl. Then she talks about the innumerable stars that shine across the infinite sky. Infinite means endless sky. Clouds take new shapes with every passing moment. That means she is referring to change, that you have to change according to the situations in your life. Then she talks about how the wind makes trees dance with unhindered passion. That means without disturbing anybody, it dances with unhindered passion. Then water, and then she is telling you about water, that without a hint of ego changes its form according to the dictates of the sun and the wind. So water can change from liquid to solid based on the temperature around it, right? So we have to change ourselves according to the surroundings that we are in. And when we see a caterpillar turn into a butterfly, a flower turn into a fruit, we experience the alchemy of nature. We touch it and become gold ourselves. So that is how the author is using the word alchemy here, which means mysterious power or magic. So if you will notice that all of these things are not very, they are natural, but they are so unique in themselves, right? So they're magical. So when you are actually experiencing all of these things, it feels magical. And when we touch that, when we observe that, and when we absorb these things in our lives, we ourselves become gold. Okay? So moving on, your homework will be that you have to think and answer in your own words. As explained in the chapter, questions are based on the chapter, so you will have to write answers based on your own thoughts. Okay, then moving on to grammar, we have nouns, two types of nouns, concrete nouns and abstract nouns. Right, so what are concrete nouns? Concrete nouns are things that we can touch, see, smell, etc. And abstract nouns are intangible things, things that we cannot touch, see or smell. Okay, we can only sense them. So their ideas, concept, feelings that we feel, we can't touch our feelings, we can't. So happiness is noun, but we can't really touch happiness, right? So it is an abstract noun. And concrete nouns are anything that we can touch or see, for example, bottle, water, apple, etc. Okay, and then we move on to verbs. So there are two types of verbs, transitive verbs and intransitive verbs. So what are transitive verbs? Transitive verbs are which need an object. Okay, so that particular verbs are action words, right? So the action is done towards a particular object. So for example, Maya sent candy from Switzerland. So here the verb is sent, but the object is candy. Okay. Then similarly, the baby smiled at me. So smiling is an action and the object is me, because the baby is smiling at me. So it is a transitive verb. Then we are reading your new book. So here the new book is the object. Then intransitive verbs, where they do not need an object. So the wind blew hard. Okay, so blew is the verb and it does not really have an object, right? The water is running and we are reading. So there is, we, so if you will notice the last word, the last verb, it can be used in transitive as well as intransitive, but it depends on the context of the sentence. Okay, in this particular sentence it has an object, over here it does not have an object, that is why it acts as an intransitive verb. Okay, so now your homework is that you have to find out concrete nouns and abstract nouns from the chapter. okay, the chapter talks about nature and things and stuff like that. So you have to, what you have to do is you have to find out concrete nouns and abstract nouns. So for example, sand is a concrete noun. Why? Because we can touch and we can see sand. Then abstract nouns is infinity. We can't see infinity, right? It is an endless time period. And then similarly, what you have to do is you have to underline the verbs in the following sentences, and you have to just tell, you just have to say which that verb is, which kind of verb, whether it is transitive or intransitive. Okay. Then moving on, what you have to do is you have to write an imaginary dialogue, okay, between a bird, tree and its fruit regarding the effects of environmental changes. Okay, so you must have noticed that we are constantly talking about pollution, global house warming and greenhouse gases, stuff like that. So these are all environmental changes. So you have to write a dialogue between a bird, tree and its fruit about these environmental changes. You can write about how they are affecting, these environmental changes are affecting them. Okay, and then you have to prepare a fact file. Okay, so you can choose any particular plant or tree. For example, they've given you coconut, neem, basil, cactus, apple, etc. You can choose any of these. You have to choose only one, and then you have to find out information about that particular plant or tree. Okay, so suppose if you're choosing coconut, so name of plant or tree will be coconut. Then you have to find out what is the scientific name of coconut, in which regions and in which climate would you find coconut trees. Then what are the features of coconut trees, that means how would you recognize that this is a coconut tree. Growth, how does it grow. Then size, shape and color of that tree. Uses, how do we use that particular tree or its fruits. And any other special feature that the tree might have. Okay? Thank you.